in four games without Kevin Durant and are now waiting to find out if they'll face the Bucks or the Raptors in the NBA Finals. Owner Joe Jacob says he's confident that Durant will be back in time for the finals, but the truth is they might not even need him. Since KD went down, the Warriors are 5-0, and while their scoring is slightly down, they're giving up far fewer points, grabbing more rebounds, and getting more points from their bench. I can't believe I'm saying this, but I don't think they need KD to win the title. It doesn't matter the opponent. This is the best team in basketball.
Yeah, I agree with you. They don't need KD, and it is about the opponent. These two opponents that are remaining, they're going to face one of them. Dusted and disgusted, as E-40 would say. Like, just, you imagine being at the Warriors, somebody house, watch party, Draymond having it, wings out.
Yeah.
We eating, and we watching this game. And we've always watched the game through simulation when we're not on the court. Right. When you're watching somebody else, you're like, oh, this is our next opponent. Let me watch. Mm-hmm. Okay. Oh, Brick. Whatever. Brick. Oh, damn. We would have made 2-0.
All right. Yeah. Right.
Mario coins start going off. Ding, 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 ding. Like, the Warriors will light this team up in their dry patches. It's over. So, KD, whatever that's going to do in terms of impact towards his free agency, that is a political decision you have to make in terms of, hey, we need KD or we don't need KD. But beyond that, in terms of X's and O's on the court, they can win without KD. Trust.
Yeah, I don't think they really need KD for these two teams. Maybe if they were meeting the Houston Rockets, different. Mm-hmm. But when you
because they struggled without KD against Houston.
A whole series, though. Come on, wait, a series?
More of a whole series, but
a little different.
They beat him in Houston.
Well, yeah, I know they beat him in Houston, but still.
They lost to him, though. Yeah,
but still, it's more of a, you know, for me, I think watching Milwaukee and watching Toronto and watching how they shoot, how prolific that Golden State is as far as shooting. Mm. And watching how Milwaukee and Toronto play defense and they walling up, you can't wall up Golden State. You don't need KD for that. KD can sit and relax and rest and then cheer on his boys. But for right now, the way Golden State is playing, neither Milwaukee or Toronto can beat them, to me.
And I have to agree. And I said a while back that the Warriors needed KD to win a championship. But after watching these two teams in the Eastern Conference and watching this Golden State team demoralized Portland. I mean, it was child abuse. I mean, what they did. And the thing is, if they don't have KD, then you have the Warriors pick. Then I have the Warriors pick to win in 5 or 6 games. But if you have KD, then I'm looking at a sweep.
It's a sweep.
But the question is this. We keep talking about KD. DeMarcus Cousins also is getting healthy. Mm-hmm. So do he come back? What kind of effect does he have on the team?
I want to go a different direction. I want to get to why Golden State doesn't need KD in this postseason. And to me, it comes down to one person and the best playmaker left in the playoffs and maybe the best playmaker in basketball is Draymond Green.
Oh, well, thank you.
And they don't,
without a doubt.
Either Toronto or
without
Milwaukee have anybody
without a doubt
that can be a playmaker.
Without a doubt. Guard 1-5. No. Guard 1-5.
But not just this year in the offense.
No, period. And I'm glad you said that, Whitlock, because I said this time and time again, he is everything that you want in a basketball player.
Yes, you did.
Draymond brings. Tell me something he can't do. Yeah, he's a streaky shooter, but anything else outside of that, tell me what he can't do. He gives Golden State swagger. He brings the tenacity. He brings that edge. And I'm telling you, man, Golden State, Draymond Green is invaluable. I mean, you can't find another Draymond Green in this league. You cannot find another one. And you're dead right with that. It's not another guy like Draymond Green in this league.
And you're talking about playmaking. Playmaking is not necessarily offense. When I look at playmaking, for me, playmaking is initiating fast breaks off of loose balls, off of charges, deflections. And that's what Draymond Green does the best out of anybody in the NBA, right? Anybody. So just because, you know, he come down, miss rebound. If I don't know how to dribble, I have to give it to a guard first. He's dribbling the ball after a miss rebound. These guys are just going. Like, he's so important. He does so much for that team. I mean, like I said, we had this conversation the other day. Yeah, Stephen Curry, you're impressive. But Draymond Green, you are super impressive.
I'm going to say that I'm a little older than you guys by about 10 years. And so I don't, but I know y'all watch, but I just don't know how much y'all remember. But when Draymond gets the ball at the other end in the paint, it reminds me, Magic Johnson used to get the ball like that. And then he come rushing down court, and you'd be like, even watching,
you'd be
like, oh my God, here he comes. What's about to happen? Because he could go all the way to the hole, or it was going to be Worthy on the baseline, or it was going to be Byron Scott hitting a three, or he just pull up and say, come on, big fella, I'm going to throw it down.
Everybody can
And you just, I don't, who else has it been like that when they just rushing up court, and it's particularly a big man with that kind of vision? I hate to compare him to Magic,
but it's true.
That's true.
And that decision
that's
making.
A great point.
A lot of guys run, look, let's be respectful. A lot of guys try that. A lot of guys do that. John Wall, Russell Westbrook.
Jason Kidd.
We've seen it, but then the IQ has to kick in, Jason Kidd level, Draymond level, where you're making the right decisions and pace of play. The thing I love about him the most, not to be redundant what you guys said, but a little different, is he makes them comfortable outside their comfort zone. Mm. That tenacity, and I play with guys like that, like Rodney Harrison, Junior Seau in football. When they pushing it like that, you like, but then that becomes your new norm. And you can see that swag and that confidence and everything comes out of those guys based on Draymond saying, we always going to max this thing out. So that, like you said, is invaluable.
It's invaluable. And then, like, even I was more so impressed that, and see, what a lot of people don't understand is that Draymond Green actually played the five at Michigan State. So he's comfortable with playing different positions. And I was more impressed on the series when they played the Rockets, how he made Capella a non-factor on the defensive end.
He's amazing.
He made Enes Kanter a non-factor where he couldn't even play. But his decision-making, man, and I have to applaud his professionalism because he didn't make the All-Star game this year. He had an up and down season. It was, you know, things weren't going well for him. What he did was the last part of the season, he locked in, he lost 25 pounds, and he got ready for this long haul. And right now, man, he is the heart and soul once again of this team.
I'm going to say this, and I don't mean this at all as a shot at Kevin Durant, but it's just the reality. Kevin Durant made the Warriors lazy. They all could relax a little bit.
And I want people out there to understand what you're saying. It's not a knock on Kevin Durant, but when you have the best player in the world, when I'm at home, I'm a cook, okay?
Right.
I can cook, but if somebody's gonna come in the house and cook every day, I'm gonna let them cook.
Right.
I can clean my own house.
Right.
But if I wanna pay somebody to clean the house, I'm gonna let them clean the house.
Luxury.
There's no knock on Kevin.
Luxury.
It's a luxury.
It's a luxury.
And sometimes people get lazy with that luxury.
Yeah.
And again, Draymond Green, Steph Curry, and to a certain degree, Klay Thompson, now that KD's gone, they've all stepped up their effort. The guys on the bench have stepped. Everybody's playing hard.
Absolutely.
And it's beautiful to watch.
And on another note, just to end, once again, Klay Thompson don't get enough credit. And he's been the best two shooting guard in this postseason.
Yeah.
To me, he's been the most consistent, and he's been the best two guard in this season on both ends.
What up? Manny Pacquiao and Keith Thurman are here to talk about their upcoming showdown, but we start today with the NBA. All right, one of my favorite lines from the TV show, The Wire, is when Prop Joe says that New York enforcer Brother Muzon got more bodies on him than a Chinese cemetery. These NBA playoffs are starting to rival Brother Muzon. Giannis Antetokounmpo, the Greek freak, is currently in the emergency room. His status as an NBA superstar is in critical condition. Milwaukee police claim Toronto small forward Kawhi Leonard is the primary assailant in the attack on Giannis's reputation. I disagree. It's playoff exposure. No sport has a greater regular season, postseason disparity in terms of intensity, strategy, and style of play than the association. The NBA postseason deconstructs regular season false narratives. In round one, the playoffs snatched Russell Westbrook's soul and exposed the irrelevance and fraudulence of his triple-double gimmick and maddest man on the planet shtick. Dame Lillard and the Trailblazers gave us a peek behind the Westbrook curtain, and there was nothing back there but senseless turnovers, three-point bricks, Barry Trammell questions, and Paul George's regret. In round two, the postseason clown James Harden exposing the limitations of isolation basketball, step-back three-pointers, and analytics that demand nothing but long-range shooting. Even without Kevin Durant, Golden State vanquished Harden's Rockets with relative ease. And now in the Eastern Conference Finals, the playoffs are coming for the Greek Freak. the high-flying, high-energy big man, and favorite to win the MVP.